Can I be honest with you this morning? Is that okay? Well, I'll be honest with you all the time, okay? But this morning, I'm having a little bit of a rough time. Pastors are allowed that. Is that okay? If you know me, you know that I'm a planner. I'm ahead about 6 to 10 to 12 weeks usually on my message. I study hard. I work hard on my messages. I put hours and hours and hours in on every message. And about once or twice a year, I come to Sunday morning and God just says, nope, that's not what you're preaching. You're preaching this. And if I can just be honest with you this morning, that's sometimes frustrating. So God and me have had a few words this morning. And that's okay. God's big enough for that, right? But I'm out of my comfort zone this morning. If this is your first week with us, or your first week back in a while, you got to come back next week. Because things will be back to normal then, but things are not normal today. Is that okay? Things are just a little bit different today. So we have no notes, the computer, none of that is gonna be working for you today. You actually might not even want to take notes today. Because I'm just gonna say, God gets his way. And well, before you clap too much, raise your right hand with me. Everybody's got them up, right? And repeat after me. I realize this word today is a word from the Lord. So if my toes get stomped on, it's all about Jesus. It's all about me. And Pastor Ryan's off the hook. Amen. All right, so remember that as we go on through the message today. One of the reasons that this message is a little frustrating to me this morning is literally, I just got a couple of notes that just quickly wrote down. One of the reasons that this message is frustrating to me today is not just because it's spur of the moment, and God knows I don't like that, but because it stomps on my toes. Did you hear that word correctly? I didn't say steps on. I said stomps on. But I do have to say this, as frustrated as I am this morning about where we're going, I know this is a word from the Lord. And so I'm going to encourage you this morning to open yourself up and hear this. Maybe God changed this message this morning for you. And so oftentimes, as Francis Chan says, we can come into church and be head nodders and ameners. And we can just say, oh, praise God, but really not let it sink in to ourselves. Really not allow God and the Spirit of God to just mess us up. Can we do that this morning? Can we allow the Spirit of God to just mess us up today? Is that okay? Remember, if it's not, you can't hold me accountable. So if you have your Bibles with you this morning, turn with me to Matthew chapter 7. We're going to get back to the Spring of Hope. Next week, we'll get right back to it. We're still going that direction, still doing all of that, but we're just jumping out for 1 week. Matthew 7, 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. But only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. This is the word of our Lord. We thank you, God, for this day and this opportunity to dive into your word. And God, I pray your grace upon me as I just navigate my way through this morning. But God, I pray, as we did earlier, that we would all be open today to hear what you're saying to us. I pray that the preacher this morning would be open, Lord Jesus, to hearing what you're saying to me. And that all of us today could come to this humble place where we say, this is the word of our Lord for me in my life. Open our eyes, open our ears, open our hearts to you this morning. And we pray as we always do, Lord Jesus, that you would speak today, for your servants are listening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Remember that hymn chorus, He is Lord? You remember that? He is Lord. He is Lord. He has risen from the dead, and He... Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus. And I heard some good harmony over there somewhere. Is he? I want to talk this morning about what it means to fall under his lordship. What does it mean to say Jesus is Lord? Because remember, if he is Lord, then he is Lord of me. To sing that song is to make a declaration that he is Lord of my life. So what does it mean to say he is Lord? I think that we often, maybe we don't even understand lordship in 2018. The lordship is as it was understood, especially in the early church and in biblical days, what it means to say Jesus is Lord. Because oftentimes we begin to think, if I say he is Lord, that means that I've asked him into my heart. Or if I say he is Lord, that means that at some point in my life I knelt down and I said a prayer. And sometimes we think he is Lord means that I've got myself right. I believe in Jesus, and one day I'm going to go to heaven. What does it mean to say he is Lord? He is my Lord. Because if this passage that's a part of a greater passage, and we're going to talk about that, but if this short passage that we read this morning tells us anything, it is this. There will be some who misunderstand lordship and don't make it. Wednesday night in Bible study, we've been talking about some really tough language in Scripture. And this is some tough language. In Scripture, there will be some who do workings of the Lord, who call his name and lordship, that don't fall under his lordship. Are you with me? And so what does it mean to say he is Lord? Now again, this passage is a part of a greater passage. It's a part of the greatest sermon that was ever preached. It's a part of the Sermon on the Mount. As Jesus is coming along and he sees the great crowds that were following him, and he just sits down on the side of the mountain and he begins to preach. And he preaches the greatest message ever preached. Here's your homework. Go home, study the Sermon on the Mount. It's beautiful. It's amazing. And he talks through many things, and it's coming to this climax when Matthew begins to recount Jesus's verbiage in this sermon. Matthew says that Jesus proclaims that we are to produce good fruit, that we are to be known by our good fruit. And bad fruit that's not good, is good enough to be thrown away. It's good for nothing. And we're known by our fruit. And it's that same John 15 passage, that understanding. And Jesus goes on with this same breath to continue and talk about lordship. What it means to fall under Jesus's lordship. Fruit is representative of the true us. Us who call him Lord, but may not be surrendered to his lordship. What does it mean to call him Lord? For Jesus to truly be my Lord. Hope you're listening this morning. For Jesus to truly be Lord means he has to be Lord of everything in my life. For Jesus to truly be Lord means he's Lord of my relationships. That I don't get to pick and choose who I like and who I don't like. That I don't get to pick and choose who I forgive and who I don't forgive. That I don't get to pick and choose who I'm going to ignore and who I'm going to pay attention to. That I don't get to pick and choose how I'm going to treat somebody else. Because remember this Sermon on the Mount that Jesus is preaching. He's sitting there on the side of the mountain and he says, you have heard it said. You've heard the rabbis teach you. You've heard it over and over again. Love your neighbor. Love those who take care of you. But I tell you, love your enemies. See, we don't catch the depth of that. Because this is the same Jesus who said, love God with everything that you are, everything that you have, all of your totality, and love your neighbor as yourself. And he takes it a step further even with this, and he says, love even your enemies. If Jesus is truly Lord, then he's Lord of every relationship in your life. He's Lord of your marriages. He's Lord of your relationships with your kids. He's Lord of your relationships with your family. Look to your left. He's Lord of your relationship with them. Look to your right. He's Lord of your relationship with them. If Jesus is truly Lord, then he's Lord of your relationship with that person who you just don't care for. And if somebody doesn't come to mind right now, then you're not listening close enough. If Jesus is truly Lord, then he's Lord of every relationship that you have. Does he receive honor and glory from every relationship that you have? If Jesus is truly Lord, if I'm to fall under his lordship, then Jesus is Lord of my attitude. Now, can I just tell you this morning, this is the one I don't like the most. As I was penning this, I said, God, do I have to do this one? Because you know me as the Huggy Bear Pastor. But if you want to know the truth, I don't always have the best attitude. I feel like I'm an eternal optimist when it comes to the Word of God and Christendom, but honestly, I can be a pessimist. I can be negative. But if He is truly Lord, then He has got to be Lord of my attitudes. My attitude has got to reflect His lordship. If my attitude, and I'm speaking me here, you may want to pull your toes back anyways, but if my attitude is not reflective of Jesus' lordship, then He's not truly Lord. Are you with me? Because Jesus is sitting here, and He says, you've heard it said, you've heard the rabbis teach, do not murder. That's a biggie. That's one of the big ones. You've heard this since you were little. Plain and clear. But I tell you, don't even become angry at someone. Can we just be honest this morning? Some of us have been negative this morning. Some of us walk around with a negative attitude. Some of us, believe it or not, come to church with a negative attitude. If he is Lord, if I fall under His lordship, then He is Lord of all. Including my attitude. If He is Lord, then He is Lord of my finances. Oh, here He goes. Well, Jesus knows about my financial situation. Jesus knows that things are just tight. After rent or mortgage and all of the utilities and the kids' ball games and eating out 7 times a week and all of the groceries and the cell phone bill and the movies and our internet at home, we got to have internet at home, and all of the things that we go out, and we got to have guys' night or girls' night, and we spend all of this time and all of this, and everything that we have is centered around me. And then the offering plates get passed on Sunday mornings, and I just watch it go by. See, we can't say He is Lord if He's not Lord of our finances. And amen is okay there. If He is truly Lord, He's got to be Lord of my all. I can't pick and choose and say, I want Him to be Lord of this, but you know what? This over here, I'm just going to hold on to really tightly because, you know what? Jesus understands. Now, let me tell you what Jesus understands. Jesus was in the synagogue. He was at church with those who were following Him. And He watches as people in big flowing purple robes, signs of royalty, walk up to the offering and drop them in one by one. And everybody looks up and everybody says, oh my, how faithful they are. And Jesus, you can just see back there yawning. And they are, and He's thankful for their faithfulness. But then all of a sudden, this old widow in rags walks up with 2 fractions of a penny. And when she drops them in the offering, it makes no noise. And she's thinking to herself, unlike the rest of them that want to be seen, she's thinking to herself, I hope nobody sees me. And Jesus gathers up all that were around him and he says, hey guys, look at her. And they say, who? All we see is that old lady that probably shouldn't even be here the way she's dressed. This is church. She needs to have on her Sunday best. That's another sermon for another day. He says, she is faithful. She's got nothing. Yeah, she gives. Guys, if you could just understand that lady's faithfulness. If you could just wrap your minds around what it means to be faithful, well, Jesus understands. Jesus understands. After everything that I do, I just don't have anything. Timothy Gray started coaching, refereeing, soccer 2 weeks ago. And the very first thing he did on Sunday, he didn't get paid a lot. The very first thing he did on Sunday is he walked in and he tithed that morning 10% of what his paycheck was. You know, how old is Timothy? 15? 15-year-olds have better things to do with their money. They do. There's games, there's stuff, there's toys, there's 15, there's girls. I got a 14-year-old, I know that. But a 15-year-old comes in with $20 paychecks and says, I'm going to give God what belongs to him because he is Lord. And Jesus understands. Jesus and me have had conversations about this. He knows I want to, but... You know, I'm not even talking about the scripture, and there is plenty there that talks about how blessed we would be if we were to trust God and to give. And church, I'll just tell you, our finances here are great. They're in great shape. This is not a, hey, I want to guilt you into start giving more to the church. This is not about that. This is about lordship. And if I am going to declare him Lord, then that means he needs to be Lord of everything. In my life, everything in my life. If he is Lord, that means he has to be Lord of my worship. That preacher didn't preach a message that spoke to me this morning. You know what? He needs to preach on holiness more. You realize every message is on holiness. Amen. If it's on Jesus, it's on holiness. You know what? We just don't rock enough. We need more rocking worship. Those drums need to be louder. You know what? We don't need drums at all. Drums are abomination of worship. We need more praise songs. We need more hymns. We need more... Here's the thing, church. I have my rathers too. But when we fall under this, I want, it ceases to be about lordship, and it has more to do with me. I love that old, he is Lord. I asked Kathleen this morning. I said, do you know that? She says, no, I don't know. I was thinking to myself, oh, that was a staple growing up. I love that song. And but oftentimes we can take that so far that I want this and I wish it was this and I don't really fit with these words that are up there and I wish it would be more like this or I want it to be more like that. And we do a blend here and we try to blend. The worship is all about the message and all of that. But I got to tell you, church, when we come to a place where we want it to be something that fits our needs, it's not worship anymore. It's not lordship anymore. Because lordship, let me tell you, church, ain't about me. Lordship is about surrender. You see, the whole understanding of worship came from the sacrificial process. It came from understanding what it means to not live like this, but to live like this, to be poured out, as Paul talks about, but poured out on and around the offering. You see, what would happen in sacrificial process is they would sacrifice this perfect animal, and then with that sacrifice, this burnt offering, the smoke would go up, and it was to be holy and pleasing to God. It was all about a gift to God. And then the priest would go into the Holy of Holies, and they would burn off incense. And that incense burnt up was for one reason, and that was to be holy and pleasing to God. Never once did they say, I'm gonna sacrifice this because it's my favorite animal. This is my favorite scent of incense, guys, so I'm doing this one because I like it the best. Well, church, if he is Lord, then he has to be Lord of everything that I have and everything that I am. Everything that I am about has to be about him. And in this Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is sitting there, and they said, well, teach us how to pray. And Jesus says, well, here's how you should pray. If you didn't realize, we don't have time today, but go back and look at the Lord's Prayer here in the Sermon on the Mount. It's all about worship. It's all about worship. I believe it's a cadence to live by, that it's not just a prayer that we say exactly the way it said. We all know it, the King James Version. We grew up that way, right? But it's so much more than that. Well, do I say these exact words? Is it just a model to pray? I think we miss it when we have that question. I think it's so much more. It's a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle of being given over in lordship. Our Father, who's in heaven, hallowed be your name. There's no one on the seat ahead of you. You are King and you are Lord. Your kingdom come. Your will be done. And we go through this prayer, and at the end of it, I love that verbiage. To yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. This is lordship. This is a falling under his lordship. If he is Lord, then he's Lord of everything. If he's Lord, then he's Lord of my eyes. The Sermon on the Mount's going on, and Jesus is sitting there, and he says, you've heard it said, all of the rabbis have taught you, you know the language, don't commit adultery. That's another one of the big ones. But I tell you, don't even look at someone lustfully. I had an old DS that used to say, you can't help the first glance, but you can sure help the second glance. See, the Jews understood that you placed your eyes on, it was a window into your soul. And when you looked, when you gazed at, you were allowing that you gazed on, that you placed your eyes on, into your whole being. And so that you placed your eyes on was let into your heart and let into your soul, and it began to be who you are. Some of us, if we're really going to declare his lordship, then we need to start focusing on what we allow our eyes to be placed on. You know, I cell phone somewhere anyway. Used to be, I was talking to a young man recently, and doesn't go here, a teenager. and that struggles with pornography. And let me just say, pornography is at everybody's fingertips today. Used to be you'd have to go in the store and grab that top magazine and walk up and buy it in front of everybody. Now, in the privacy of your own home, you've got your cell phone right there. Paul said, we are in a broken and depraved generation. Here we are too. If you got kids, grandkids, understand the world they're growing up in. If he is Lord, then he has to be Lord. We don't pick and choose what he's Lord of. If he is Lord of my life, then he is Lord of my mouth. James talks about this in Scripture. That the tongue is so evil that you can't put back in something that's already come out. Gossip is Satan's favorite tool. Gossip will kill a church faster than anything. Watch it happen. Speaking poorly about someone else to someone else. You know, we in the church know how to use prayer requests as gossip too. You realize that, right? Oh, I just got to tell you about so-and-so so we can pray for him. Gossip is so harmful. Gossip happens all around the church, and it's so harmful. If he is Lord, he has got to be Lord of my mouth, my complaining, my negativity, my gossip. If Jesus is Lord, if we're going to declare that, then he's got to be. Because he didn't come die on a cross, rise again, fulfill prophecy, seated on the throne to the right hand of God, for us to live any way we want to live. If he is Lord, we have to live like it.